Cerebellar gate. Before talking about the cerebellar gate, let us first have a glance of station and gate in general. Station is a way a patient stands, and it comprises of attitude, posture, or manner of standing. A healthy individual stands erect with the head up, chest out, and abdomen in. Abnormalities of the station may be an important indicator of neurological disease. Patients with unsteadiness of standing often attempt to compensate by placing the feet wide apart in order to stand on a broader and steadier base. In cerebellar diseases, the patient usually stands on a broad base. Now, what is gait? Gait is a way the patient walks. It comprises of stance and a swing phase. The functional task during the stance phase is to bear the weight, while during the swing phase, the functional task is to advance the limb. The gait abnormalities of the cerebellar diseases are caused by the involvement of the coordinating mechanisms in the cerebellum and their connection with the higher centers. In mild cerebellar diseases, there is an inability for tandem walk, while in the severe diseases, the gait is usually clumsy, it is staggering, unsteady, irregular, lurching, titubating, or a wide-based gait. The leg movements are usually erratic and step length varies unpredictably. Cerebellar disease can be anatomically localized to different areas of the cerebellum based upon the difference in the gait that is being observed. The cerebellum basically comprises of vermis and the two cerebellar hemispheres. So, if the lesion is localized to the cerebellar vermis, the patient will exhibit a lurching or a staggering gait. There will be no laterality, and the ataxia will be equally marked on both the sides. Whereas in the lesions of cerebellar hemispheres, what do we observe? The patient will stagger and deviate towards the involved side. So for example, if there is a lesion on the right side of the cerebral hemisphere, the patient will deviate towards the right side. And if the lesion is in the left cerebellar hemisphere, the patient will tend to deviate toward the left side while walking. Now let us understand this on a patient. In a normal gait, the base is normal, that is, the feet are not wide apart. So to say, the medial malleoli pass within 2 inches of each other during the stride phase. There is no swaying from side to side. The patient can make quick turns and the arm swing is equal on both the sides. When a normal person is asked to perform the tandem walk, he can follow a straight line. The toes of the first foot touch the heel of the next foot at each step, and hence he is able to perform a tandem walk. Now let us observe the gait of a patient who is suspected of having a cerebellar disease. There is wide-based gait. We can observe the patient is swaying towards the left side while walking. He is trying to take the support of nearby objects in order to maintain the balance. There is slow turning. And now we observe that there is a swaying towards the right side. So most probably this patient has involvement of the cerebellar vermis. Similar type of gait is also seen in patients with acute alcohol intoxication as well. Here we have another patient who is unable to perform tandem walk. He has difficulty in initiating the movements. In an attempt to walk tandem, the patient sways on either sides. When asked to perform walking in a straight line and walk heel to toe, the patient is unable to do so because of loss of balance. Also, we can see that there is a difficulty in turning and resuming the movements again. And his movements are slow and unsteady. Hence, there is an impaired tandem walking.